So this lecture will be about some general overview on the field of de novo design. What does it mean? How it can be applied? What approaches are exist? And so on. So what is a de novo design? So de novo means from scratch. So you create molecules from scratch. But actually, it is not fully correct because anyway, you use some information for this. Some reference compound, some known activity values for existing compounds, nevertheless. Originally, when these approaches were developed, they were used to create ligands for proteins which don't have complexes in 3D structure. So when you have just a 3D structure of a protein, you can think, consider to construct your, you have two choices. You can screen your available compounds against this target. Another choice, you can construct your molecule which fit perfectly the binding pocket of your protein inside this cavity from fragments, from other ways. So we will talk about this. And this kind of approach is named de novo design. However, today, de novo design is much wider application and definition, so any kind of modeling stuff can be used in a combination with the structure generators. So we will talk about this later. So this is just a brief for understanding. So here is a classical workflow how molecules and structures are designed. So usually this is an iterative procedure. So you have some structures at the beginning, some reference compound, template, whatever. Then you generate some new structures, score them according to your scoring function with your in silico tools, perform selection of those compounds. You select the most promising ones. And if they not reach the threshold of activity, you repeat the iteration with this new subset of compounds again, change their structures, score, and make selection until you accumulate required compound at the output with the desired level of activity. So this is quite simple strategy. And it was implemented by many groups, and there are a lot of approaches exist to this. So when we talk about de novo design, one of the core features is the generation of structures. So because those structures should be reasonable, synthetically accessible, diverse, novel, to be able to patent those structures and so on. So structure generators are a really key issue for such kind of research. And there are two groups of approaches for structure generation. One of them use machine learning methods, generative deep learning networks. Other used some more chemically reasonable way how to construct structures. And we will start from this group of methods. So atom-based, it's even from the name, it's understandable that it constructs structure atom by atom. So here is an example of a Molfer approach. And it encodes just 9 basic rules of a structure changes. And applying these simple rules, like add atom, remove atom, add bond, remove bond, and so on, you can enumerate most, I think, systematically the whole chemical space. So it is quite basic rules. And you can generate a lot of compounds using very, very simple rules. I can compare this with ab initio calculations. So simple rules, and you can generate whatever you want. However, these approaches are not so popular. So the first approaches were developed at the end of 90s. And the new one was appeared just several years ago, developed in Prague. This Molfer software developed in a Dan Swozil group from Prague. I didn't find any, how to say, practical application of this tool. So in their publication, they showed that it is possible to to generate the sequence of transformation going from one compound to another one. And they showed that it is possible to achieve. And they claim that compounds which are close to the both ends could be reasonable to more detailed investigation. So those compounds are more similar to the target one, for example, and they might be reasonable to investigate them experimentally. However, this approach is nice, so it generates a lot of structures. But the first thing that it doesn't consider chemical validity of structures. So structures which are generated with these two can be invalid. So yeah, you can link atoms correctly. But for example, it can, in my opinion, generate some sequences of oxygens, nitrogens, something like this. So it is not reasonable. So it's too basic to. Another thing is synthetic accessibility. So it cannot control it in any way. So you just need to apply some external scoring function to estimate synthetic feasibility of those compounds to select the most feasible ones. And another thing that, yes, it allows you to systematically enumerate the chemical space. But in this case, you will fight with the combinatorial explosion. So the number of compounds will be really large, and it will not be affordable by any computational resources. So these steps that which they performed in 22 steps, I don't know how much time it will take, but I expect that a lot, really a lot, because on each iteration you can generate millions of compounds. And if you generate from these millions of compounds millions from each of them, this will be a huge progression. So usually it is reasonable, of course, to derive some scoring function like similarity towards the target compound and select on each iteration compound which are most similar to the target one and perform the modification just of a small portion of compounds on each iteration and such in such a way sequentially to be close to the target structure. And here I just collect some issues regarding the atom-based approach. So in my opinion, it is really nice to perform local exploration. So I see that these two can be really useful if you just need to optimize your structure locally. So you just want to explore the local chemical space around your lead compound, for example, to optimize the ADME properties or something else. In this case, this would be reasonable to enumerate all possible candidate molecules and screen them. The novelty of structures and structure diversity is quite high, but here are some remarks that it can be achieved with a lot of stages of mutations. And that is why that is difficult to say. So if you apply many steps, then your generated set of compounds will be really diverse and novel. But if you perform just 5-10 steps, that is difficult to expect something completely different. Because you make very small steps in the chemical space exploration. And as I said, so chemical validity of the structures does not control. So they just checking some simple valence rules and so on, charges, and there are no control on synthetic accessibility of those compounds, and you can find this combinatorial explosion issue. Another group of approaches are reaction-based approaches. This is the most probably natural way how to construct your compounds, because it is like really follow the chemical intuition. So you have some building blocks, you can combine them by the coupling reaction and obtain some product. It is quite simple. So this also just one of examples. This approach more popular than atom-based. There are several examples of such approaches and software. This is just one of them named DOCS, developed in the group of Professor Schneider from Zurich. So it is quite comprehensive. So they collected in this software, as I remember, 58 reaction rules. Also, they prepared the building blocks, because those building blocks should correspond to some requirements. So they shouldn't be too large. So there are some restrictions on the lipophilicity and molecular weight of those compounds, which will be used as a building block. They also shouldn't contain the similar or the same functional groups to avoid difficulties in synthesis or competitive reactions. Applying these rules, they collected something about 25,000 building blocks, and they use this approach quite frequently, and there are quite a lot of publications published using this approach and tool. So how it is done? So at the beginning, they take some template compound or reference compound, they name it template, which is desired activity, known compound. And then they just try to generate, using reaction-based approach, some structures which will be similar to those template compound. This similarity they usually measure with machine learning methods like QSAR models, based most frequently on Gaussian processes, but other types of models can be used as well. At the beginning, they just take some random building blocks, and then they investigate what kind of reaction can be applied to this building block, because usually there are several possible reactions. They perform this quite randomly, so they generate the adduct of this building block with the smallest building block for each reaction, score these products roughly, and take those reactions which lead to the best compound. And then enumerate already on the second stage systematically all possible coupling of this compound by this reaction, selected reaction. After that, those compounds score it, selected best compound, and this compound can be recommended for testing. If they already achieve the desired activity value, or if not, they can be returned back and grow further. So in this way, you can construct compounds not only in one step, but in two or three steps even synthesis. Here are just example of application of this approach. So they try to find modulators of gamma secretase, which is responsible for accumulation and accumulation of beta amyloid peptides in our brain, which can cause Alzheimer's disease. So they took these two compounds as a template, and using their approach, they designed those compounds using one-step synthesis. So the synthesis was really nice, so they performed it according to the predicted conditions, with high yields, and that is okay. However, those compounds which were designed were inverse modulators, so they increase activity. So that is not a so-called successful example, but here is a success that those compounds which were designed by a computer can be easily synthesized, and they are ligands of the target to which they were designed. So yeah, it is much more difficult to predict pharmacological effect, functional activity of those compounds, but at least they were ligands of this protein. Another example, more recent one, probably the most recent one, which I found in the literature from this group. They developed modulators for retinoid receptor. The idea of the this study was to develop compounds which will be similar to natural product. So before, they screened the natural product library with in silico tool, select the most promising natural compound, test them experimentally, and after that, they tried to use them, those compounds as template. Here is a newly identified natural product against this type of receptors. And they use this compound as template. They generate with this doc software some promising candidate molecules. This reaction is also very quite nice. So in one-step synthesis, they obtain these products according to reaction schemes. And when they investigated their activity, many of those compounds showed quite promising activity levels in comparison to template compounds which are natural product. So this is another application of such an approach. Quite easy and effective. So what are possible issues and advantages of this approach? The most obvious advantage is that generated compounds, structures are chemically valid and synthetically accessible. I cannot say that it is 100%, but very high probability, extremely high. At the same time, there are no combinatorial explosion, of course, because they use, nevertheless, quite limited library of building blocks. And this mainly limits the diversity and novelty of structures which are generated. So it depends on your reaction rules, which you extracted, and your building blocks you used. However, I think that using even one-step reactions, you can generate really diverse set of compounds. So maybe less diverse, of course, than atom-based, but on a quite reasonable level. And as well, those compounds, I think, should be novel. And the third group of approaches is a fragment-based approach. Is there a line between atom-based and reaction-based? And this group of approaches may be the most popular ones, and they implemented in many types of softwares and were used in many studies. Here I just select the most, maybe the major modes of structure modification grow when you just replace hydrogen with some fragment, mutate when you replace your fragment with another fragment, link when you have two fragments and you just find a linker appropriate, or reduce to remove some unnecessary parts, for example. However, in reality, I see mainly grow and link operations. Sometimes you can find some regarding mutate, and I never saw some reduce operations in existing software and approaches. So usually molecules are grown from the small fragment to bigger molecules. And this scheme also shows the main strategy how compounds are discovered. So if you have, for example, binding pocket, you can grow inside the binding pocket this fragment, some randomly selected fragment, or you can dock those fragments, select the best one, and then start it to grow them. Or you can consider links. So you just dock multiple fragments at once. They bind to different sub-pockets, and then you just try to find the linker, which will be optimally link those fragments. However, in my opinion, the most general one is the mutate and link operation, because grow is just the replacement of hydrogen with a fragment. It's a subset of operations like mutation. So in mutation, you just replace not hydrogen, but any kind of fragment with another fragment. And link, when you just create from two fragments one molecule. Okay, so as I told you, there are many approaches. I selected several examples of them. This approach, named BREED, it uses for fragment-based development 3D structure of protein ligand complexes. So this is one of the examples when you don't construct your ligand inside the pocket, but you have to have already those complexes in 3D structure. And how it works? So for the same structure, they took two ligands which are co-crystallized with this protein and tried to superpose those two structures. those structures should have some common core, for sure. And after this overlapping, the software determines which fragments are different and switch these fragments between these two core fragments, which binds to your protein. So this fragment linked to this one, this to this one, and obtain new compounds. So this is quite nice way because it gives you compound which with a high probability fit your binding pocket and provide some novelty as well. However, of course, the novelty of the generated compound is quite limited because you cannot take a lot of structures of complexes of your ligand. It's quite expensive. And for known complexes, it is already done. So this procedure is quite expensive. And of course, you have, in this case, co-crystallized compounds with the same core. So the novelty is not so nice. However, it produces really active compounds. So in their tests, they show that it is really works. It really works. Here, just one example. Unfortunately, probably you don't see the structures. So those structures are known compound. Based on these structures, they are designed those ones by combining those fragments from these reference molecules. And they even discovered highly potent inhibitor in such a way. And it is computationally not feasible, so this procedure can be done in seconds, and it works. Here is another approach which I wanted to show you. It is quite nice idea behind it. So it have quite complex workflow, but I just briefly discuss. So the idea was they took some small fragments and perform molecular dynamic simulation of those fragments inside the binding pocket. And during this molecular MD simulation, at certain with certain step, time step, they identify which atoms cannot be linked. And they create bonds between fragments. At the same time, some bonds can be cleaved, broken. So it looks like a bowling soap for fragments inside the binding pocket, and they randomly connected in a chemically reasonable way between each other and broken. And in such a way, they reconstruct some compounds which fit perfectly this binding pocket. Of course, this work is more than 20 years old already. And when they performed this simulation, they don't use modern molecular dynamics. So they consider the protein rigid, and only ligand was flexible during this simulation. Also, they restrict formation of some bonds to receive reasonable structures during this procedure. And they showed in some examples, but only retrospective ones, how it works. And here, just two examples. For the first run, they took something like 1,000 of such fragments. And they tried to reconstruct the conformation of a chain of a known hexapeptide, which are known inhibitor. And after many simulations, they were succeed. And the highest ranked structure which were discovered, it's just like a chain of glycines, and it was quite perfectly, this highlighted structure, quite perfectly corresponds to this dark structure, which is a reference with polypeptide. After that, they add fragments to this cavity, which represent side chains, and continue these simulations. So these chains are tried to find the optimal orientation inside the cavity, create link to the backbone atoms. And in such a way, they're discovered some new polypeptides, which also fit the pocket and corresponds to the crystal structure of a reference compound. However, they didn't synthesize them and test, unfortunately. That's why it is difficult to say is it reasonable or not, but the approach is quite nice. And another study, what they did on the same protein target, they used more diverse set of fragments, quite simple, some methane, ammonia, water, and so on. And they also perform the same simulation in order to discover non-peptide inhibitors, non-peptide inhibitors. And they were also succeeded, so they found some structure which also quite nicely correspond to the reference compound. So that is nice. However, unfortunately, they didn't experimentally validate those results, but as an approach to the generate of a structure, it's quite interesting. Another approach is more sophisticated. They used so-called Markov chains. So if you have a database of compounds, you can fragment them and you can calculate frequency of linking of different fragments to each other. And you can create the table of frequency. So how frequent this fragment linked to this one, to this one, to this one, and to this one. And you normalize, so the sum of these values per row should be 1. So, and it represents somehow the probability of fragment to link to another one. And this table can be represented as a Markov chain, so these edges are directed and they these values are correspond to values from this table. And the structure generation is sequential, so you start from some randomly chosen fragment, for example, from phenyl. Then it stochastically, but according to this probability, they choose another step. For example, in this case, it chooses this one to furan, add furan to this fragment. From furan, it can go here, backward, here, or attach another furan. And for example, it goes here to attach fluorine atom. At some point, they also have a probability to branch or linearly grow their fragments. So if the program decides that it can branch, it can return back to furan and consider how to grow it further. And it can attach another phenyl group and so on. So in such a way, you can design quite reasonable chemical compounds. And it is nice. Of course, it depends on the database of fragments you use. And however, it doesn't take into account the wider chemical context. Some structures can be not chemically accessible in such a way. For example, it can attach groups in ortho position, which cannot be in such a odd position or chemically synthesized. However, it is quite nice and rather fast approach. Here is another one approach which consider chemical context of attached groups. So they have quite simple idea. So from the initial structure, they fragmented, and those fragments are stored with annotated information about attachment point. So to what kind of atoms this fragment can be attached. And after that, they can just link them, those fragments, considering these types of attachment point and create chemically reasonable structures. But again, this approach considers just one atom of chemical environment, similarly to the previous one. And it might not be enough in some cases to obtain really feasible compounds, and they cannot control this. So these are example of approach which I developed recently. It is not published yet, but I think it is quite nice addition to this cohort of approaches, and it is more advanced in my opinion. So the idea was quite simple. So if we have two fragments in the same environment, it means that they can be replaced, each other. That's quite easy to understand. So in this way, we can just take compounds, exhaustively fragment them, then take environment of certain radius for each attachment point and store them in a database. So those compounds, they have the same context of a radius 3, and this probably can be synthetically reasonable to replace them with each other. So that's easy. And you can create a database with environment and possible fragments which correspond to this environment. And after that, if you have a new compound, you again can fragment it, find the fragment, generate its molecular context of a given radius, look at this database, and found all fragments which can reasonably replace this fragment from the database. This procedure is quite fast, and you can generate really millions of compounds. It depends, of course, on the diversity of your initial library, which you have fragmented and converted to this database of fragments. You will always receive chemically valid compound in this way. And here I perform some simulations how results output depends on the radius you choose. And I showed I selected 500 compounds from the drug bank and perform one iteration of mutate operations. So I replace fragment with a new one, but it should differ not more than two heavy atoms from the size of the replaced fragment. And we can see that increasing the radius, the number of generated compounds drops quite significantly. Here is the logarithmic scale. And at the same time, the diversity of compounds, which were measured as average pairwise tiny motor distance between generated compounds, the diversity decreases, but not such significantly. But nevertheless, it decreases. More interesting was how the radius will affect the odd chemotypes which will be generated. Because if you consider the wider chemical context, you will generate more conserved structures. So less number of new chemotypes will appear. I perform a simple investigation, so I just exclude from the initial library of compounds, because for this simulation I took the whole Campbell for generating all fragments. And here I remove compounds containing Payne's fragment from this Campbell database and generate new database of fragments and use them just to randomly stochastically explore the chemical space starting from benzene molecule and perform 100 of iterations. On each iteration I took randomly 20 compounds and repeat this procedure 100 times. So there are millions of molecules were generated, and then I just test how many Payne's fragments are occurred in these molecules, new generated molecules. And here is a number of distinct Payne's patterns which were found for these compounds depending on the radius which were considered. And here I saw that the number of distinct patterns are decreased. That is logical. So it confirms this idea that taking more wider context, you receive more conserved chemotypes of generated compounds. And in such a way, you can implicitly influence the generation process. And the nice idea that you can take your proprietary library of compounds to use for fragmenting and then take some reasonable size of a radius, and you will generate more conserved compounds which are follow chemistry developed in your laboratory, for example. However, more interesting was to measure how can we influence the synthetic feasibility of those generated compounds. Of course, we cannot do this directly, but we can do this indirectly. From the initial database of compounds which were used for fragmenting, we remove compounds according to the synthetic complexity score. Synthetic complexity score is just machine learning methods which predict synthetic accessibility of molecules. This model was developed just recently, last year. They used quite nice idea behind it and based on the neural networks as well. So I just filter out compounds with a certain threshold. So the less synthetic complexity score, the better. So they are more synthetically accessible compounds. I again regenerate a database of fragments. The number of fragments decreased dramatically to the synthetic complexity score 2. And what you will see again, so the number of compounds in this case, here is, if you don't see, here is the initial Campbell set, and here is a database of fragments generated from those libraries with increasing more strict threshold on synthetic complexity. And we see that again, number of compounds decreased, but not that much like in previous slide. And at the same time, diversity also decreases, but again, not that much. But more interesting how synthetic complexity score of the generated compound changes. And here I just put a bar plot of difference, pairwise difference of synthetic complexity score between generated molecules and the parent molecule. The parent molecule in all these cases were 500 drug band compounds. And what we see is that increasing the threshold to select more and more synthetically accessible compounds, the synthetic complexity of the generated compounds are really improved. And in this case, the most strict one, the mean value of the improvement is 0.26. And according to the paper of researchers who developed this measure to estimate synthetic complexity, they consider that 0.25 should correspond to one step reaction. So it means that it can be interpreted in such a way that those compounds in general will require one step less synthesis. And in such a way, you can generate using such a filtered, pre-filtered database of fragments, generate quite diverse number of compounds, and at the same time, they can have better synthetic accessibility. So at the end, fragment-based approaches are quite nice. So they allow you, they are quite flexible in that meaning that you can change the size of a fragment, and in such a way you can control the exhaustiveness of a search. So for example, at the beginning, when you have not optimal compound, you can make large steps in your search of in the chemical space. So you can attach large fragments and roughly explore wide chemical space. When you already found some promising candidate molecule, you can decrease the size of fragments which are replaced and explore chemical space more locally. So this is very nice flexibility of those group of approaches. Of course, the diversity and novelty of the generated compounds depends on your initial library, and it should be maybe lower than in atom-based approaches, but it should be higher than in reaction-based. But again, it might require some steps. Not in one step, but several steps. With my improvement, probably this structure generator will be really nice. So they will be able to generate chemically valid and even synthetically feasible molecules. So at least you can control this implicitly by controlling the database of initial compounds for fragmenting. It is less susceptible to combinatorial explosion problem, but it is still exists because there are, in some way, in some cases, it is possible to generate millions of compounds from one parent one, from one not paired compound. So in some cases, it is really complex. Here are just a summary of those previous tables. And we switch to the second group of methods, which used machine learning. to generate structures. As yesterday Thomas told you, some recurrent neural networks exist which work with the text in particular. So they are used for text recognition, translation, and so on. And it, since structure can be represented by a smile string, so it's just a text string which represents our compound, many researchers decided that it can be reasonable to use this recurrent neural network to generate smiles using the known smiles. The idea is very simple how they work. So they took in the beginning some atom or symbol. In this case is a C atom, aromatic C. It encodes just one, so one hot encoding, as Thomas said you. Then this model returns some probabilities of choosing the next symbol and selects the symbol according to these probabilities. And this symbol goes as an input onto the next step. And again, it generates this, the next symbol, and in such a way, it generates the sequence until the symbol ends. So like a dot in a sentence. So it is quite simple strategy. It was implemented already in many studies by many researchers, and I even don't know how many papers were published on this topic already. So this really hot area. And how they can be used? So they can be used in an unsupervised way, since it is unsupervised method. You can. These researchers took the wall Campbell and train their network on a wall Campbell database, and then they just generate compounds from this model sequentially. So since this is a stochastic model, it can generate a lot of structures, a lot of possible strings, which can be valid smiles or not valid. You will see. But this is a completely stochastical exploration of a chemical space, so it can generate any kind of molecules like water or cyclodextrin, whatever. So you don't control this process. To add some control on this process, they, after building the recurrent neural network, they retrain this existing network on subset of active compounds against particular target. And in such a way, they create a bias in their model, and they started to generate compounds which are more similar to those ones. So in such a way, they perform fine-tuning of their general model. So in the first step, the model just learned how to generate valid smiles, and on the second step, they just learned model to generate smiles which will be active, reasonable, against particular targets. Here is an example of unsupervised generation. So they apply this approach, generate about 1 million of compound, and many of those smiles were valid. It is quite interesting result, because when I read literature, I found very different estimations. So different groups published very different results. Some of them told that we obtained just 50% of valid. Some of them told that we obtained 100% of valid smiles. But the truth is something between, I believe. Some of them were already presented in the initial database of Campbell, which were used for training, so they were removed. Some of them were duplicated. Quite a lot of them passed filters of AstraZeneca. And just 12% have the same scaffolds as training set compounds. So this shows that this compound could be novel. And according to the distribution, by the physicochemical properties, this is a picture of multidimensional scaling. Here the blue dots are Campbell, and green dots are generated compounds. So according to this distribution, you can see that those generated compounds occupy almost the same space, like a Campbell. So those generated compounds follow the physicochemical properties of those compounds which are used for generation. So That's nice. I didn't find papers where this approach were validated prospectively in some experimental way, but I think that if they are not published yet, they will be published quite soon, because there are a lot of group of people who works on this kind of approach. However, this approach has some drawbacks, because Smiles representation, it is not natural for chemical compounds at all. So this is just a string which was developed artificially by human to obtain some human readable text representation of a molecule for storing and exchanging data. And the same compound can have many, many Smile strings which are valid. And okay, you can say that we can generate canonical representation which are canonical Smile, but different software generates their own canonical Smiles. That's also a problem. And when this model generates these Smiles, you can never be sure that it generates canonical Smiles as well. So in last time, there started some efforts were made to train models on different representations of the same compound. But the main idea in this case that those different Smiles, they should be mapped on the same latent space in your model. So model should recognize that those different Smiles represent the same chemical entity. And this is the main issue and which is now tried to solve. And again, if you consider other things, so the generated compounds about the synthetical feasibility, it's difficult to say something because I didn't found anything regarding this topic. It is not discussed extensively, so it generates chemically valid structures more or less, so it also depends on the research group and implemented neural network model. The novelty and diversity of structure is quite high in my opinion. However, again, there are quite a big issue in the community. They don't have some common metrics and approaches how to validate those generation approaches. So everybody invents their own approach, performs some calculation and shows these numbers, but you cannot compare these numbers with another approaches because they use different paradigms and approaches to validate the developments. However, these are promising strategy, but I think that the future, nevertheless, for graph generation networks, which can generate molecular graph, not Smiles. There are some publications already exist, but we will not stop on them, at least now. So the next issue of de novo design is a scoring function, which we are used to rank our compounds. So now we can use any kind of a scoring function. You can use similarity search, pharmacophore models, docking, molecular simulation, machine learning methods, whatever you want, ligand-based or structure-based approaches. It doesn't matter. The more important thing is that your scoring function should provide you quite smooth surface for optimization. Because for optimization algorithm, it is much more harder to find maxima or minima on such a, how to say, sharply spaced shape. It is much more easier to follow this smooth space because it is more predictable. If you make small changes in a structure, you have some small changes in a property predicted. And it follows the main paradigm that chemical similarity follows the biological similarity. And in such a way, if you make small step, you can go from top compound to the bottom one. And it is sometimes not acceptable. Therefore, you should consider that your scoring function should be more or less smooth. Okay, yesterday we talked about the QSAR modeling, and QSAR model can be considered as a complex function. Yeah, it's a model, but actually it is a complex function which depends on many variables and provides some output. And since this is a complex function, we can perform numerical optimization or analytical finding to find the combination of parameters which lead to the top active molecule. So we can numerically or analytically optimize this complex function and find the optimal solution. So that's quite easy to understand. And this solution will correspond to some numbers in this chemical space represented by descriptors. That's easy. And on the next step, we have to generate structure from those descriptors. And if it will be achieved, we can generate exactly compounds which correspond to active prediction of our models in one step. That's perfect. The bad news is that encoding of a structure with descriptors is just one way. So it is extremely difficult to go backward from descriptors to structure. However, this paradigm is quite nice, and there were several attempts to achieve this. One of the first publications were from Fulon group. He developed signature descriptors, which can be considered something like atom-centric fingerprint or augmented atoms, Morgan fingerprint, extended connectivity fingerprints. They have many synonyms. So they just create substructure and all the attached atoms up to some level. After that, they create system of equations, linear equations. Here are an example of them. There are really a lot of them. And this system of equations are just required to make, to introduce some restriction when you will perform interpretation step, this inverse step. Because initially they built a linear regression model. From it, it is quite easy to understand which combination of parameter is optimal. And these restrictions just to introduced to limit the generated compounds to some reasonable structures. So after this, they started to combine those fragments to each other to find the corresponding one, which are substructure of each other, and then in such a way, sequentially, try to combine all fragments in one structure and reconstruct the whole structure. I didn't put here some examples. It was applied several times for several tasks. Especially, it was very successful on reconstruction of peptides because the linear representation is quite easy to use this approach. But the limitation is that it is quite complex and it works just with linear models. There are a lot of equations and you solve it. And for complex problems, that is not feasible to use this approach. More interesting approach was suggested by Professor Funatsu from Kyoto. They have a little bit different paradigm. They also built some linear regression model, but actually it is not important. After that, they, using Gaussian mixture modeling, they investigate the bounds of regions with favorable activity levels according to this model. And when they define these limits and this preferable space for compounds, they started to generate the structures. The important thing is that they used so-called monotonically changed descriptors. It means that when you add at least one atom to your molecule, the value of this descriptor is increased. And in such a way, when you grow your molecule, the value of descriptors will be always increased and you will go only in one direction in this chemical space. And then This procedure is applied sequentially, started from the simple fragment, it becomes growing. And when you go to this region, favorable region, you continue to generate compounds until you generate compounds which are already outside this region. So compounds which contain descriptors which are outside these ranges, and you stop. So in such a way, you perform inverse QSAR task, but in a little bit different manner than in the previous one. So it is possible to generate a lot of compounds, and this strategy was validated retrospectively on a data set of Solubility and some others. And they still continue this approach, develop more sophisticated models and so on, but the general idea is similar. How deep learning can contribute to inverse QSAR problem? So you already saw this picture yesterday. So, and as Thomas explained, autoencoders take some input, encode them in a lower dimensional space, and then try to decode from this lower dimensional space the same output as input. And this dense representation can be used for optimization problem. Here is an example of a paper. Thomas already showed you this example yesterday, but without much details. So the idea was they took smiles, encode them with a network, with encoder, to quite small dimensional latent space. After that, you can use those values from the latent space variables as descriptors to train your machine learning methods, supervised methods to some target property function. And after that, you can optimize this function, machine learning methods, like in inverse QSAR using the conventional techniques to find the region with the top activity. So the combination of latent space variables which corresponds to high activity compound, which should correspond. And then when you go back from this map to this map, you just start your decoding, taking this point as input for decoder. And it starts decode and generate smiles of compounds which should correspond to this region and, as expected, should be active. So this is more comprehensive strategy. But it is quite nice, in my opinion. It has some potential, of course. They applied this strategy to some retrospective exploration and in retrospective study. So they tried to optimize this combination of parameters. Q-mid means quantitative estimation of drug likeness, and SAS is the synthetic accessibility score. So they try to develop compounds which will be drug-like and at the same time will be have lower synthetic synthetic accessibility. They took this compound as a starting one, performed a lot of simulations. Here are just these compounds represent this way from this starting point to this one because they took many starting points which are marked with the gray crosses here. And here is the optimal space of those molecules, and all of them were gone in this direction, and then generate sequentially those compounds, finally, which have preferable parameters. So they have quite high drug likeness, so 0.9 almost, quite low synthetic accessibility, around 2. And it in the top compounds in the list. However, even in their publication, I note that this compound probably not feasible, actually, synthetically. And this is the miss of the synthetic accessibility score and this generation program as well. Because I tried to look such compounds, but internet said me that such compound don't exist. Even in it, they investigate only by quantum chemistry. So they are too reactive, they are too unstable, it's not possible. So it means that this strategy is nice, but it still can generate some irrelevant structures. And the number of irrelevant structures is unknown because it is quite difficult to estimate and find them. There are no common rules how to filter them and find. And how much time I have? Almost yet. Okay, so maybe, maybe just this example of multi-objective optimization. So when you perform de novo design, you can use not only one parameter, but you can optimize simultaneously several parameters. So you can optimize activity against your main target or targets and some off targets simultaneously and obtain molecules with a nice profile, pharmacological profile of activities. Such an idea was implemented by Gisbert-Schneider, which I mentioned today, who developed the DOC software. So they selected some template molecule which can possess some activity towards serotonin receptors. They applied this DOC approach with 58 reactions, generate more than 100,000 compounds. They filter out of them those which are not passed paints and admin filters. And then they apply Gaussian mixture models to predict their activity against a variety of GPCR receptors. Finally, they selected just four compounds for synthesis. They were successfully synthesized those compounds. Here are their structures, and here is the structure of those template molecules which were used to generate those ones. So similarity is quite low in all cases. But these models, which were used for prediction, they use pharmacophore representation of compounds. So maybe in a pharmacophore space, it is much better because this is just a structural similarity measured. And when they performed the testing, they found that some of them were agonists, some of them were antagonists. For example, compound 6 and 7 were possessed some quite high agonistic activity, and agonist of 5-HT2B receptors can provoke some side effects, severe side effects, and it is more reasonable to look for antagonist of these receptors. However, compound 8 has quite nice output, so here is the experimental measured affinity against different targets, against different GPCR receptors. And it is really successful example because they could derive molecule with quite nice selectivity towards just one type of a serotonin receptor. And it doesn't possess affinity, considerable affinity towards dopamine, adrenal receptor, and so on. So this is a really nice example. However, in my opinion, it is quite difficult to expect that multi-property optimization will be always successful because if you use many models in parallel, every model has its own error. And if error of models not correlated with each other, it means that the errors will be accumulated. And if you, for example, can predict property one compound with 90% of accuracy, if you predict two properties of this compound, you will obtain 0.9 multiply 0.9, just 81% of accuracy. And if you will increase the number of simultaneously predicted properties, the overall accuracy will decrease. So not all properties which were predicted will be correct, and only a very small portion of compounds will correspond to your predicted profile. But this is only true if you have uncorrelated models. Of course, if some models are correlated, the situation will be better. But this can make really complex the task of a multi property optimization step for de novo design. So, okay, so if I'm already out of time, I'm finishing. So if you have some questions, remarks, you can ask me now, later. At least I see that you didn't sleep. That's good.